what's up, guys? Time to review yet another episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and this time it is for the episode entitled Love in the Time of Hydra. I see what they did there. Not just because we got Edward James Olmos. I don't know if you guys even bother to get the reference, because Live in the Time of Cholera. Anyways, now if you guys have been watching my reviews as of late, I've been spitting out a bunch of nines saying how the momentum of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has been rapidly progressing, holding no punches and delivering us all these bombshells while at the same time just going through certain events without wasting any kind of time, and I've been loving that about S.H.I.E.L.D. And that's why I will take a couple of points off this week, because this episode was more of a catch-up type of episode where certain things are simply just progressed and caught up with, rather than revealing more things like we've done in the past couple, like S.H.I.E.L.D. has been doing in the past couple of episodes. But don't get me wrong, I appreciate that, because after dropping so many bombs, you do need that one or two episodes to kind of catch up and really, let things rest and breathe for a while before delivering another kind of punch, one that I'm coming to expect at least towards the season finale. So I appreciate episodes like this where we simply just get some more information that it's not too dun-dun-dun, you know, too revealing that it's a major event, but more of a progression type of thing where we simply just absorb more information so that we can learn for future events that are going to happen in the show. And one of the things that we learn about is this real S.H.I.E.L.D. that Mac was talking about at the end of last week's episode, and we get plenty of that this week. And we also learn who's in charge, this man named Gonzalez, played by Edward James Olmos, who I kind of predicted in last week's episode's review. I mentioned that Edward James Olmos was going to be the guest star for this episode, and probably considering this his role in the show, he's probably going to appear maybe once or twice more in the remainder of the season. But it is revealed that this guy is actually in charge of this real S.H.I.E.L.D., who's basically tasked to making sure Coulson doesn't screw up. This is like a separate division that kind of seceded from the S.H.I.E.L.D. that we were led to believe was legit before the whole thing with Hydra happened and Winter Soldier. And basically, they're the ones who are making sure Coulson has the right head on his shoulders, which they believe is actually not the case. They feel like Coulson has been compromised, and he needs to be relieved of his duty. Not so much killed, because they're not necessarily Hydra, thank God, but they simply just don't want Coulson in the picture because they feel like he's too much of a liability. And Hunter, who is there, completely is opposed to this because he's taken a liking to Coulson despite his differences and despite Hunter's nature, and therefore escapes by the end of this episode. And what is he going to do when he takes off? Is he going to go back to the base and tell Coulson? Is he going to be intercepted by Bobby, who is being tasked to intercept, essentially, and take care of this by Gonzalez? And that'll be interesting to play out. And I do like the idea of this other division of S.H.I.E.L.D. because, you know, within secrets, there's going to be secrets and just secrets. And that's all S.H.I.E.L.D. has been good for. But I really hope that this has a larger plan in the Marvel Universe than just this little drama within S.H.I.E.L.D. I hope this gets mentioned somewhat in Age of Ultron or any future Marvel movies, because for now, I don't feel a very big picture with this new S.H.I.E.L.D. I mean, even the offices look kind of small. That is until we learn that this is actually a giant carrier ship in the middle of an ocean somewhere at the end of the episode. But I don't know, there's just something kind of small to this real S.H.I.E.L.D. I was hoping for something a little bit more grandiose. And I was kind of disappointed to learn that everything just looks like it's being done in a conference room. So I really hope that this thing branches out more so than what we got in this episode, but still a promising start to this really intriguing aspect to the bigger picture that is the Marvel Universe. Speaking of catch-up, Ward and Agent 33 finally return in this week's episode, and this is why I feel like the momentum was slightly diminished from last week's episode. It was still there, it wasn't completely lost, but because of the fact that we're playing catch-up and absorbing more information, the same thing kind of happened with Ward and Agent 33's particular mission in this episode, which it basically has to do with 33 and Ward trying to first find the man who built this technology about the face mask in order to fix her face after it was heavily damaged in the first half of this second season, in which Agent 33 was practically scarred. And afterwards, they infiltrate Talbot's base to extract Bakshi so that Agent 33 can essentially have her revenge for who practically scarred her for life, both physically and mentally. And to be honest, their little mission wasn't as intriguing as who was involved in that mission. In my opinion, between the two, I thought Agent 33 was probably the most interesting thing about this particular subplot, because I was surprised by how many layers they added to her about how troubled her psychosis is at this point, because, you know, she's looking in the mirror and she's seeing all these other different faces except her own until the end of this episode. And honestly, that's something rather complex, and I found her way more fascinating than I even did Ward. And don't get me wrong, I liked the direction they took with Ward in this second season, but Agent 33 was a pleasant surprise in this episode. And also, her little game of pretending to be different people while infiltrating Talbot's base was also pretty fun. What I thought was a little too over the top was Talbot this time around. I don't know what was up with the writer behind this week's episode, but they made Talbot just a little too cartoony. I don't know, he was having too many antics that were too much of a cartoon character, as opposed to how hardened he was in previous episodes that we've seen him. This time, you know, he's pinching on shoulders' cheeks, and he's going off on these stories on soldiers or office assistants that clearly don't want to hear him. And I just felt like he was handled a little weird compared to how he's been in previous episodes. But we can clearly tell that out of the two, the only one that actually has a genuine sense of emotion is 33, because Ward is still manipulating his ass off to get what he wants. And I still like that they're keeping the character intact, but man, he is a villain through and through. And I'm just looking forward to that big confrontation we're probably going to have towards the end of the season between Ward, 33, and Coulson's team, now that Coulson actually does know through a video feed with Talbot that Ward is still out there with 33 and they're up to something. The only other subplot that we got in this episode this week was Sky practically being isolated by Coulson for her own good and for everyone else's until she finds a way to hone her powers, especially after being given those particular gloves from Simmons that will hopefully let her do that. And it is kind of you kind of do feel the gravity of the choice that Coulson had to make by taking her to this cabin and just letting her be there all by herself. And I actually kind of felt for Sky, but, you know, this feels like just simply a upgraded version of what we were already doing with Sky, putting her in the cage within the bus, only this time it is completely away from the rest of the team, so I didn't feel like it was brand new territory. We got some more interesting character moments with both Sky and Coulson, but besides Coulson's little inspiring monologue about comparing Sky to that red Corvette, there wasn't anything there that amounted to anything new. So yeah, sure, the pacing was a little bit slower and we didn't get those big dun-dun-dun moments that we've been having in the past couple of episodes of S.H.I.E.L.D., but I still appreciate what this episode did, which is to play catch-up, because if you start delivering those big surprises one after another every week, then they're going to start to dilute in the surprising nature of those events, because you're just giving us more and more and more. So I appreciate how this episode kind of slowed down and just said, okay, hey, look, this is what's going on, and this is how we're going to catch you up, especially on these characters like Ward and 33, which you haven't seen in quite some time. And I appreciate that. Plus, there was some interesting stuff in almost all of these subplots, especially how surprised I was at Agent 33's complex character. So not necessarily one of the big standouts of S.H.I.E.L.D., but still a very solid and appreciative episode from S.H.I.E.L.D. So for that, I give Love in the Time of Hydra a high 8 out of 10. So let me know what you guys thought of this week's episode of S.H.I.E.L.D., and what do you guys think of the asshole from Dawn of the Planet of the Apes being an asshole in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.? I'll see you guys next time.